and rehabilitation module in MBBS fourth year. This is the disclosure. Tables included in this lecture are not the property of myself and were obtained from Google Images search referenced on the slide. The material is being used for education purpose only, and Amkhan does not claim ownership and rights to this material and will not be printed or copied in the handouts. So the introduction. So in the previous lecture we have talked about Parkinson's disease and spinal cord injury, and in this lecture we will discuss about traumatic brain injury. It's another significant cause of physical disability. These are the objectives. By the end of this lecture, the fourth year MBBS students will be able to discuss main classifications of traumatic brain injury, describe the pathophysiology of traumatic brain injury, and explain the rehabilitation process of traumatic brain injury. This is the definition. So what is TBI? Traumatic brain injury occurs when the brain is injured due to an external force or trauma. So if there anything happens, like somebody head is hit against anything, or maybe there is an external force, then it could injure the brain. And it's most frequently occurs in adults, and adolescents is trauma. So the most of the cause of the TBI is trauma. The damage is not congenital or perinatal in nature, so it's due to an external force and head injury actually mainly. Nature of traumatic brain injury. It's a major cause of disability, and much work has been done after Second World War, and because in the Second World War there were many soldiers were penetrating gunshot bullet injuries, so then they started looked into it in quite detail, because it can produce a focal neurological deficit similar to stroke. So it depend upon the injury of the side. It could present with the stroke symptoms, and a road traffic accident and falls could be the other major cause of the traumatic brain injury. The two major classifications. One is closed injuries, in which one the skull is not penetrated, and open injuries in which the skull is penetrated. Road traffic accident and falls causes multifactorial diffuse lesions, so there could be some physical, cognitive and neuro behavior impairments in that kind of injuries. Children with traumatic brain injury have complex issues that affect their biological, psychological and social development. So if somebody have an injury, like a child have an injury to the brain very early in their age, so it will affect their normal biological growth and the development of their psychological and social development. So they may present with the symptoms like cerebral palsy. Pathology of the traumatic brain injury. It could be primary injury, so that's immediate and direct damage post trauma, and it could be cortical contusions, and occurs at the crest of the gyri and extend to variable depths depending on the severity. So the primary could be just immediate and direct damage post trauma, and it depends on the severity and the depth of the injury. It can occur on the under surface of the frontal lobes, frontal and temporal tips. May produce focal cognitive sensory motor deficits and seizure disorders. Think about the pathophysiology of the TBI further. There could be other types, could cause diffuse axonal injury, and that's acceleration and deceleration motor vehicle accidents. And if you have a lateral impact, that will lead to poor outcomes. So if something is hitting from the sides of the head, that could cause a vast damage, and maybe the patient will have a poor outcome. Midbrain, pons, corpus callosum and white matter could be damaged, and responsible for initial loss of consciousness. So the patient can, in this diffuse axonal injury, the patient can be unconscious. There will be axonal swelling and disconnection, and that's the risk factor for the development of Alzheimer's disease, dementia. Measures of injury severity. So again, it's a common scale. We use Glasgow Coma Scale, and we measure eye opening response, best verbal response, and best motor responses, and we give them a total score that is 15. So if they are spontaneously opening the eyes, that's giving the score of 4, and opening the eyes to speech, then to pain, and no response, that ranges from 1 to 4. Oriented to time, place, and person, that is score of 5. Confused, 4. Inappropriate words, 3. And incomprehensible sounds, 2. And no response, 1. And best motor responses, obeying command, so they obey the command, moves to localized pain, flexion withdrawal from pain, abnormal flexion and abnormal extension, and decerebrate. So it ranges from 1 to 6. So it's total score of 15. Anybody who scored from 12 to 15, then it's a minor injury. From 9 to 11, it could be moderate, and anything below 8 could be classed as a severe injury. Then the secondary injury is damage to the brain tissue after the primary injury. So when the primary injury happens, there is a delayed onset of the injury, and that causes local ischemia that may lead to direct neuronal necrosis and direct trauma to blood vessels, systemic hypoxia, and cerebral hypoperfusion. So there will be less perfusion in the cerebrum, and that could be due to secondary injury, delayed onset after diffuse axonal injury. The cerebral perfusion pressure is important to measure, which is the difference between the mean arterial pressure and the intracranial pressure. So that could be measured, and that recommended value for the CCP is between 50 to 70 millimeter of mercury. Neurodiagnostic tools. You can carry out a CT scan which you can detect intracranial hemorrhage, brain swelling, hydrocephalus, and infarction. It's not sensitive in identifying small contusions, white matter injury, or in the evaluation of posterior fossa. Can carry out MRI scan because in this one the lack of X-ray exposure, greater resolution in the brain stem, better identification of isodense collection of blood, and detection of small white matter lesions. And but it takes longer to perform, and the patient must not have any MRI incompatible implants or equipment like a heart valve or whatever. In that case, they may need to go for an open MRI. So it's again a good reliable diagnostic tool for the neurodiagnostic for the traumatic brain injury. The rehabilitation process, again very important, that's the main part of the this module, and it begins at the emergency department. So as soon as the patient comes to emergency, the rehabilitation will begin. And it may continue for several years. So because if the patient have severe head injuries and they have a lot of brain damage, then they will lose their physical activity or physical movements in the arm. So it can take, depending on the type and lesion and the area, it may take several years. And sometime it needs to be aggressive neurosurgical intervention as required. So when the patient come to the emergency department, the neurosurgeon will see the patient, and if they need any urgent surgery or any surgical intervention, they are the right people to decide on that. In the ICU, if the patient is admitted to ICU after the neurosurgical intervention, or even with no surgical intervention, if the patient is in ICU, then the rehabilitation process will start in the ICU.